All living creatures need three things to survive: a home, food, and a mate. A farmer can provide two. Mother Nature takes care of the third. This meadow has been 800 years in the making. Nobody can hope to recreate that. But what farmers are being increasingly asked to do is to sow from a bag a collection of plants that tries to provide pollen and nectar that once came from these natural sources. The demand for food production in the 40s and 50s and the mechanisation of agriculture led to major changes in how the British countryside was managed. All kinds of diverse habitats gave way to intensive farming methods. Farmers answered the nation's call to feed the people. They did this so well that by the mid-60s, everybody had their daily bread. Intensive farming worked for food production. Now it can work for wildlife production. We will never be able to recreate the ancient flower meadows, but what we can do is to provide new habitats with a proven wildlife benefit for birds and insects.
For the last 17 years, CEH has undertaken research to underpin the management prescriptions in the agri-environment schemes. It's also been very important for us to work with practitioners and farmers to make sure the solutions we develop are workable and cost-effective. ELS is the entry-level stewardship scheme. It's the basic agri-environment scheme, it's non-competitive, and it aims to get a wide range of farmers into the scheme to deliver simple yet effective environmental management. The booklet contains the background of the scheme, how ELS works, how to apply, any additional requirements the farmer may need to consider, such as cross-compliance, and most importantly, a list of options and management prescriptions and the points associated with them. HLS is the higher level scheme, which, unlike the entry level scheme, is discretionary and geographically targeted to high priority situations. It aims to deliver much greater environmental benefits and therefore requires a higher input of support and training to the farmer.
Natural England works with a wide range of partners to deliver environmental stewardship, but the key partner is the farmer. We've got good coverage of environmental management across England, but there are gaps where we need more farmers to do more. My role in that is, as the national lead on arable, is to make sure options are the right options and that advisors and farmers have the right tools to manage the landscape for wildlife, which is what we're after in the end. We've got a national target for 70% of land under agreement, but it's more important to have agreements with the better options in it that deliver for the birds and the invertebrates across the landscape, and that's what we're focusing our attention on.
Farmers receive a lot of public money, and like it or not, it's probable that the political agenda is going to include environmental management for public money, the supply of what we call now public goods. The environment happens to be one of those goods, and it happens to be one of the things that farmers can supply.
The management on the farm, we try and put the wild bird covers in and the pollen and nectars. We do to our best ability. Like farming, it is a job that you have to manage. You have to use slug pellets, you have to drill, you have to prepare the ground properly and try and treat it like an arable crop.
If I was asked to pick two habitats out of the handbook, and there are dozens to choose from, the two that I feel every farmer should have a go at are pollen and nectar and winter bird food. Research has shown those two really do the business. And if we are going to increase wildlife on farm, let's go for the best and do the best.
Since 1970, there are a number of species which have declined very dramatically. The farm and bird indicator, which is a suite of 19 species, as a whole, have declined by 50% since 1970 now. There are, amongst those 19 species, some species which have done very well and either remain stable or even increased. By putting in simple measures that are available to arable farmers through entry-level stewardship, you can actually reverse that decline. Simply putting the right measures in the right place and managing them in the right way.
Every farmer understands the importance of good crop establishment. And this is about as good an establishment of bird food you're going to see. Around 2 months ago, this would have been sown. Up comes the cereal. We've got the millet. We've got a brilliant establishment of linseed. I can see a bit of quinoa in there. And kale. That's five plants established well, in need of a bit of rain, but this will give the birds the food they need over the winter months. When it comes to bird food, two things that greatly increase the chances of success is the right mix in the right place. Behind me is a specialised mix for corn bunting and tree sparrow, and we've put it right in the middle of their home territory. As you would expect, a two-year bird mix comes in two halves. Year one is the cereal and the quinoa. Year two is the kale. Problem with kale is it's inclined to shed seed. So we've introduced a new member of the team. This is fodder beet. Fodder beet is a good seeder, but above all else, it really does hang on to its seed January, February, and even into March. We're now coming up for Midsummer's Day, and this is already delivering food, insects for chicks. The bonanza of winter seed has yet to come.
The main aim of the wild bird seed mixtures is to provide birds with seed food through the winter. But because they are low input crops, without as much pesticide and fertiliser inputs, they can also double up as insect-rich habitats in the summer, which is important for birds that are feeding their chicks on insects during the breeding season.
This spring-sown mixture, like many others, is well researched. What we do know is that one of the biggest declines of farmland birds is starvation through the winter months. This is one example. There are others. This is the other alternative, the annual winter bird food mix. Six or seven species providing a much wider range of choice of seed for the farmland bird. Dominated by fodder radish. Fodder radish is one of the few plants that doesn't naturally shed seed till much, much later in the winter.
We've certainly got on really well with it, and it surprised me how well this has done this year. Third year we've had this in bird food mix, re-drilled it every spring. I thought it might have started to yield a bit less, but it looks every bit as good as it did last year.
And the thing I like about this patch is next to the trees, birds have got security, got safety, pop in for food, something disturbs them, back they go into safety and security again.
Yeah, I think the sighting's important, and this particular one works really well. And the cold spells in the winter, these are absolutely full of small birds. And as you say, they're straight back into the bushes there, and it works well from a farming point of view. We've got rid of the little short headland under the wood. Seems to be the right place to put it, really.
This is the third year where this mix has been sown in the same place. The idea is to test for how long the same mix can be sown in the same place, and we're beginning now to see a build-up of weeds at the expense of the bird food species. Weed control in bird food presents us with major problems. Mowing is not an option because that destroys the bird food, and the bird food itself is a collection of differing plants which makes selective herbicides almost impossible. One of the things farmers can do under the pressure of major weed problems is to select a range of species that are safe to a known herbicide. The problem with this is that the range of bird food species then becomes very limiting. One of the things more farmers are starting to do is to use the agricultural rotation in the world of environmental crops.
What's he got in here?
Yeah, this is a wild bird seed mix that the farmer sowed under his environmental stewardship scheme. It was sown in late April this year. We had a bit of wet weather just afterwards and it went quite warm, so it established very successfully. You can see he's got linseed in here. There's triticale, so the cereal component. Yeah. There's quinoa.
Yeah.
There's millet in the base as well.
You're not going to see many better than this, are you? He's obviously very good at this.
Yeah, absolutely, Mark. I mean, he's taken as much pride in this as his adjacent wheat crop. I mean, he has actually farmed this crop. This received a good dose of fertiliser in the spring.
Doesn't it show, though?
Yes, absolutely.
So in the winter, this is going to provide a bounty. The modern stubble, as a source of bird food, is pretty unreliable. It relies on weed seed, and most farmers don't have any. The one that really does the delivery is where we put a mixture of plants together designed to feed birds. What we have seen since early hours this morning at first light, a lot of tree sparrows here, which is very encouraging, large flocks of linnets and greenfinches having a go at the year one bird food of this 2-year mix. Is for the farmland bird a pretty grim time, isn't it? Without the food that we're going to provide, there isn't much at all. It's no wonder they starve to death in the winter. Birds on a night of -7 are going to use up huge amounts of energy just keeping warm, unless they can put that energy back. They're on a downhill slide. The food that we provide has to be to them the lifesaver they're looking for.
What we're in now, of course, is what we call the hungry gap. We're faced from mid-February to the start of the sowing of the spring crops and ripening of oilseed rapeseed, that there's a real shortage of seed food out there. Is this area actually deliberately flattened like this?
No. Do you remember 3 weeks ago, we had a lot of snow.
Oh, yeah.
But this just rotted it, pressed it down, flattened it. It was...
Well, to be honest, it might surprise you to know that areas like this are not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, you've got standing crop around a lot of the field, but often you can get a variety in the mixture by having areas of char flattened like this.
Oh, so this is not a write-off?
It's not necessarily a write-off. It'd be bad news if the whole crop went like this, but to have little patches like this is no bad thing. If you had a hectare of wild bird seed mix for every 100 hectares of arable farmland, that seed source is going to last a lot longer. It would make a massive difference. It's really the nitty-gritty of it is these birds and a lot of the wildlife on which these birds depend. They basically are dependent on seeds and insects in the farmed environment.
Beginning of April, this bird plot had done its stuff. Stuart turned it over and created the first step in his seedbed preparation. He leaves it fairly rough and open for the weather to start to break it down, to grow a few weeds. He will then spray those off, prepare a final seedbed towards the end of May. Then he'll sow his bird seed and off we go again.
Most farmers would know their lower yielding areas and their problem areas, so it's a case of looking at it on a field by field basis. And if we took Newfield, for example, on this map, it's got an awkward triangle at one end. There's a little rectangle at this end, which has got a pole in the middle. That's gone into wild bird food. The triangle's gone into pollen and nectar, which at a later date we will rotate. And a row of poles here, which we've managed to put a margin round, so we no longer have to try and spray that with a 24 metre sprayer. And of course, the top end of the field is shaded by the wood and is always very wet and rabbit damaged. So, you know, it becomes quite evident once you look at the habitats where you should put them.
For many years now, the environmental scientists have been recording the link between good quality habitats and increased wildlife delivery. The handbook in entry level or higher level is actually a distillation of all these habitats so that the farmer has the confidence through the book that he will deliver an increase in wildlife. Autumn's a very busy time. Straight after stubble, we start ground preparation ready for the next crop. And the next crop has to include the pollen and nectar mixtures. I'm in the middle of a sandwich. Pollen and nectar on my left, pollen and nectar on my right. This plot on my left is a grass and flower mix. It's recently had a trim. In a couple of weeks' time, it's going to get its full autumn cut. This is the second part of the sandwich. This is the legume half, the clover mix. It doesn't live as long as the flower, so we've had to re-sow it. But together, they work in perfect partnership to supply pollen and nectar from spring right through till autumn. Absolutely brilliant for bumblebees and butterflies, an essential part of every farm's habitats.
Bumblebees are really important pollinators of many of our crops and of our wildflowers. And so if you want to keep our wild habitats alive and our crop system sustainable, we really need to conserve our wild bees. We might want to survey bumblebees for one of two reasons. Firstly, to ask about how they interact with flowers, about which bees prefer which flowers. And secondly, it's about comparing the different numbers and species of bees visiting different habitats, particularly on farmland. Well, of our 22 or 23 British bumblebee species, only 6 are now commonly found. The decline in bumblebees is primarily down to a massive loss of habitats, of their undisturbed nesting sites, and most importantly, of the flowers that they need to survive in the countryside. It is fantastic to turn up at a place where formerly we might have just seen a crop to the edge and hardly any space for wildlife at all. We've got these wonderful areas that are absolutely buzzing with bees, and I think if we look hard we probably could find some of the rarer species here today, because we know that they do occur on this particular site and they do use the mixtures.
Here. Yeah. So the flowery mix here and the pollen and nectar in the corner.
Yes.
We've had a difficult time, wet as we can remember. It's come up raw. I've power harrowed it once, because that's all you could do, was then ring roll and then see how we go on, to see whether we go now or spring. Because if you go in spring, I wouldn't touch it again.
No, I think we go now, because it's not as I'd like to see it, but this isn't an autumn that anybody would like to see.
I want to see it work.
Drilled in the autumn will give you flowers next summer.
Yeah.
Drilled in the spring, you ain't going to get much.
Which is worth.
You've done much better than I thought you'd get to.
Yeah.
Late September, the time for autumn management of pollen and nectar margins. Field corner sown to a grass and flower mix. It's done its job for the year. Flowers have gone. What we've got to think about now is how we put this to bed for the winter. The autumn cut of pollen and nectar is key to good margin management. Not everybody has a bit of kit that size, but this estate has found that a machine like that gets the job done so quickly they can move on to the next autumn task. And at this point, let's look at what we're doing and why. 3 key points. Number 1, don't cut right up to the base of the hedge. Leave a bit for the overwintering insects and small mammals. Number 2, and you farmers hate this bit, removing the cuttings makes a better job. Please, if you can, get those cuttings removed. And point 3 very much ties in to point 2. Unless we cut, the flowers don't have the space they need to accelerate away successfully in the spring. Tussocky grass. Not the most attractive habitat at this time of year, but vital to the pollen and nectar story. This in the summer was full of small mammal holes, and this is where the queen bee goes to overwinter. Out of harm's way, ready to fire up in the spring and begin the whole cycle again. The queen bee now will be tucked up, hibernating in this tussocky grass. Her hungry period will be March, April when she comes out. We're now in the middle of winter. The early morning frost has gone, and I really want to see what things look like. We've got a green haze. Certainly some of the sown species have begun. If this level of volunteer cereals was over the whole plot, I think we'd have a weed problem. Thankfully, it's just in a small area. But I think now what we do is wait till late March, early April, and then the spring work will begin. This is another area sown at the same time as the flower mix. This one's based on legumes, mainly red clover. Looking round, most of what I can see are weeds. There are one or two very small clover plants. Ideally, what we'd be looking for from a July or August sow would be 4 to 5 plants a square metre with a minimum of 3 leaves. Then we know we've got something worth waiting for. We'll keep our eye on it and see what it looks like in the spring. Mid-April, we're back on Toft Farm. We're going to go down and see how the plots have fared through what was a cold winter. But just before that, I want to spend a couple of seconds looking at this unfarmable, thanks to the telegraph post, this unfarmable area stuffed full of wild pollen and nectar, a mixture you won't find in the book. We've got red dead nettle. We've got forget-me-not. We've got some white dead nettle. These three are vital early pollen and nectar sources. We've got a bit of teasel, we've got a bit of groundsel. The birds will pick up on that later. These almost overlooked opportunities are absolutely vital early deliverers. Last time we were on this patch, there was this light green haze. Things were just beginning to emerge. About a fortnight ago, I gave Stuart a ring and said, how are the plots progressing? Absolutely great, he said, they're going green. Came and had a look. Sadly, wrong coloured green. What does that mean? What we've got to do is to determine whether these are the species we want or whether they're the weeds that are going to give us problems. Most farmers are familiar with brome. There's also some black grass in the field. If I don't recognise a grass, the chances are it's a sown grass that's come out of the bag. For example, don't recognise that on the farm, haven't seen it before. That is actually a chewing's fescue. Over here, we've got a crested dog's tail. Dealing with the broadleaf plants can be a little bit more difficult because we're generally not as familiar with them. We've got here what looks like a shepherd's purse, yet buried underneath all that is a common sorrel, and that one is out of the bag. Farmers in the spring will make a decision on whether the autumn sown plot is good enough or needs patching. And the right management on top of that will get us to where we need to be. This is the pollen and nectar patch that Stuart sowed last September. We've got similar problems here to his wildflower patch. We've got one or two clover plants showing. In one or two places it looks good. From a management point of view, this I think is going to be easier than the flower bit. We've got groundsel. It's brilliant for the goldfinches that we saved in the winter, but this is for clover, this is for bumblebees. So the groundsel has to go through regular mowing. There are some concerns about mowing and nesting birds, but experience shows us that if we mow often enough, which is absolutely critical in year one, the birds actually don't move into the plots at all. Farmers and wildlife move from the more demanding spring workload to a more leisurely summer pace. But the bees are now at their busiest. we could be on any well-managed farm in England. Good healthy crop next to the standard or average grass margin. But I want you farmers to do more than average. I'll give you your 2 metres of tussocky grass, but what we then need are the flowers. Flowers provide the food for insects. Insects provide the food for wildlife, and that's the bit we're so desperately short of. We're on the edge of the clover crop. We've left a bit unmown so that I can show you the importance of mowing for weed control. Come down and have a look at what I mean. Poppies, mayweed, bits of brome are all producing a canopy. Under that canopy is the young clover. Unless we remove that canopy, the establishment of the clover will fail. Therefore, the clover crop we've sown will fail. We've done some mowing here, but the grass weeds are beginning to overshadow the clover. Now, when we get the mowing right, as we have here, the clover has the field to itself.
This year we took a bit of advice. We decided to broadcast it on the top and just ring roll it in. And obviously it's been a great success. The advice on when to top it and keep the vegetation down to allow the vetches and everything else to come through and the clover, it's created a nice looking plot. The most important thing is to not stick your seed too deep.
We're back in the flower patch where last year we were of two minds whether to sow or not. And what have we actually got after sowing? It may look a bit disappointing, but all the flowering species are here. They're small, but they are alive. Next year is the year of delivery. This heavy land margin is quite fantastic. It's got a score 11 out of 10 for effort and result. Let me go through what's happened. We know that the heavy land margins are more difficult than the light land. This had two lots of slug pellets because the slugs were eating everything we sowed. It had a graminicide to do battle with the black grass. It had five mowings to do yet more battle with the black grass, and we've got a result. Its position is absolutely ideal. South facing, tussocky grass next to ditch, watercourse protected, wildflower margin containing the right species for heavy land, and they are oxeye, meadow buttercup, knapweed, red clover and bird's foot trefoil. And on the outside is a path, and we also sowed the farm path with wildflowers as well, because that shorter mowed area gives us a better range of species diversity. This is near as we're going to get to one of those ancient meadows. This was sown 6-7 years ago, a mixture of 15 different flowering species, 3 or 4 different grasses, and yes, it's full of wildlife, and it does have some fundamental differences to the straight clover mixtures. The seed is about twice the price of a simple pollen and nectar mix, but this will run for 10 years and more. The one we're in now is about 6 years old, and it's getting better and better and better. The straight clover or legume mix, the seed is cheaper, and its big advantage is this 1 month midsummer bonanza of pollen and nectar. Both of these provide different jobs and different services, and both of them are needed on the modern farm. EF4, the nectar flower mix, beginning of July, maximum flowering, maximum wildlife delivery. This was sown 4 years ago, ran its course, and this is year one of the second sowing. But I want to take you a stage further. This is flowers again, but with a very subtle difference. This was sown 6 years ago and is getting better every year. Wider variety of flowers, wider variety of insect opportunity. There are four plants that I think are essential in these mixtures. Knapweed, red clover, bird's foot trefoil, and musk mallow. The marriage of these two habitats side by side is the sandwich margin that every farmer should strive to deliver. The three golden rules that increase the level of success are: sow at the right time of year, sow at the right depth, apply the right management. Mixtures divide into annual or annual biennial. Farmers should sow a wide range of mixtures containing many different seeds so that more birds can find the seed they need at the time they need it. Remember that small birds like goldfinches eat small seed like millet. The larger birds such as corn bunting eat larger seed such as cereals. It is essential to provide winter food right through till the end of March. Mid-March to mid-May covers the best sowing period. The seed beds need to be moist and beginning to warm up. Brassicas like fodder radish and kale need to hit the ground running to reduce the pressure from flea beetle. Feeding birds need an escape route, so sites next to hedges or woodland are ideal. Shelter from winter weather is a useful bonus. Difficult or low yielding areas are generally selected. Remember, in a winter drilled field, leave access for spring drilling. Produce a firm, fine spring barley type seedbed. Seed depth will vary on seed size, but somewhere between 1.5 and 2.5 centimetres will cover the majority of seeds. If seed size in the mix is very different, such as millet and sunflower, then order them so they can be sown separately. Seed rate is also very variable and depends on the species used. But remember, a slightly higher seed rate can help smother out weeds. Bird food is a crop, so manage it as such. Kale is a hungry plant, so apply nitrogen. The control of flea beetle on brassicas is essential. Some herbicides are possible in some mixtures, and cutting is certainly not a management option. Best results come from rotating bird food mixtures to new sites every third year. Mixtures can be split into two types: legume-based which major on clovers. This mixture lasts for about 3 years and provides masses of pollen and nectar between mid-June to mid-July. This is great for bees and butterflies. Recent research suggests that grasses should not be included in the mixture. Where grass weed pressure is high, graminicides can sometimes be used. The second type is flowers and grasses, based on 90% grass and 10% flower, sown at 20 kilograms a hectare. The seed for these mixtures is more expensive, but they can last twice as long as the legume mixes. Best results are achieved when these two habitats, legume and flower and grass, are sown side by side, as in the sandwich margin. Grass and flower mixtures can last for over 10 years, and they appeal to a wider range of insects. They flower for a longer period of time than the legume mixtures, but generally need more frequent cutting. When to sow? Mid-March to end of April, or mid-July to end of August, give the best results. The seeds used are slow to grow and need to be big enough before winter sets in. The difficult to farm and poor yielding areas are generally chosen. These mixtures perform best on sites of low fertility, so fit well on the less profitable areas. Soil fertility encourages rapid growth, which is counterproductive to species diversity. It is best to select sunny, sheltered, south-facing sites, as these are preferred by most of the insects we're after. Don't forget to leave access for in-season management. How to sow? A firm, fine spring barley type seed bed is needed. It is essential that the seed is left on the surface and ring rolled before and after sowing. Forget the word drilling and use the word broadcasting. Seed that is deeply sown will fail. Good establishment is essential. High soil fertility means faster growth, which smothers the sown species, so mowing is needed. Mowing won't kill the sown perennials, but will kill the annual weeds. This means flowers won't be seen in year one, but in year two, the delivery will be worth waiting for. There is a concern that mowing kills wildlife, but risks can be reduced by starting the cutting in early March, so ground nesting birds find the site unattractive. We've now got the means and the knowledge for every farmer to do their bit. Farmers are the key to a countryside brimming with wildlife.